Everybody can open your Bibles to 2 Samuel chapter 23. 2 Samuel chapter 23. I've been a Christian administrator, athletic director, and so I've spoken to lots of different ages. First time to a college group. The one that scares me are the little preschool to kindergartners. I could never get them paying attention. They'd just be going around in circles. First grade up, I was fine. So hopefully we won't have that problem here. Probably staying awake is the biggest problem here, but I'm looking. Now I'm gonna move my glasses a lot. I'm getting older. I can read fine, but I can't see you. So I need to see, make sure you're paying attention, but I'll have to take them off to read. So open your notebooks up that you take notes in. I'm a big proponent of people taking notes during church. When I was in college, I worked at a newspaper at night on Saturday nights from 7 p.m. to 7 a.m., getting the big Sunday paper out. And then I'd go to church without any sleep. That was hard. But what I started to do was taking notes that kept me awake and paying attention. So it's a good habit to get in. So I have some things for you to write down. Hopefully they'll be a help to you. So let's go ahead and pray, and we're going to start. The title today is King David's Mighty Men. So if you want to write that at the top, King David's Mighty Men. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for today. Lord, as we talk about King David's valiant, brave men, Lord, we name 37 of them here in this chapter. And how important it is for us to look at how can we be valiant soldiers today in 2017. You give us some really simple points here in this chapter. And Lord, as we talk about it, Lord, hopefully some guys and girls will decide today they're going to be a soldier for you. Let's give us a good time together in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, define the word mighty. You don't have to write all these down. You may want to hit a couple. Fearsome, ferocious, tough, muscular, strapping, strong, a mighty warrior. And then we see the word valiant. It means brave, courageous, heroic, gallant, lion-hearted, fearless, daring, unflinching, unafraid, spirited, gutsy, tough, a man of valor. When I was a little boy, John Wayne was that man. I don't know about you, but I just loved watching John Wayne movies. My dad was a big John Wayne fan. So I remember, you know, my mom's like, well, it's a little violent, you know. So then my dad, being a good father, would wait for my mom to go to bed, then wake me up so we could watch these violent movies. But back then, think about it, when somebody got shot, they just fell over. It's the way it should be. We don't need to see the after effects. But John Wayne was the man. A quote of John Wayne, courage is being scared to death, but saddling up anyway. I remember watching all these movies as a kid. And of course, my dad, as most little boys, you know, you look up to your dad as a hero. My dad was in the Navy. He was about 6'1", about 220. He was just a big guy, big beard. He looked like a mountain man. And so when the little boys in our neighborhood would talk about, my dad could beat up your dad, everybody knew my dad could. He was just a big guy. Later in life, diabetes got a hold of him, and he was a shell of the man he was. He's in heaven now. But as a little boy, I looked up to my dad. Why? Because he was strong. And when he said something, people listened. His Navy buddies would come over the house. My mom didn't like that too much. Because they would tell stories. He wasn't in Vietnam. He was actually stationed in Iceland. But apparently they terrorized that island nation. They were always getting in fights. They were looking for fights. And just the stories I would hear, and of course, did they embellish? I'm sure they did. But, you know, two guys, and this other friend of his looked like a bowling ball. He was maybe 5'6", but he was muscular. He had muscles all over. So hearing stories of these two guys, I believed them. Why? Well, it was my dad. And just the idea that my dad could beat up anybody, that was cool. Because I was kind of a runt. I was little. And I got beat up a lot. And my dad couldn't take that. So he taught me how to box. And when a guy is 6'1", 220, hitting you, you learn to defend yourself. You learn to duck. And so I learned. Not that I looked out for fights, but I knew I could take care of myself. Because if I could kind of stick with my dad, I was fine. So I grew up with John Wayne as that man. And then I had my father to look at. So when I heard this message when I was a little boy, I thought, how cool that is. Here's guys mentioned in the Bible by name, some, what they did. You know, we watch movies and we see one soldier taking on 50 guys. And we think, could that really happen? And then you read here, one guy killed 800, another 300. One guy went into a pit with a lion. I don't know about you, but if I saw a lion in a pit, I'd throw something at him. I wouldn't jump into the pit with him. And then we'll see a little later, it was actually snowing. So not only was a lion in a pit, it was snow on the ground. So that means footing wasn't the best. So these guys were a man's man. It's amazing reading this. Is this true? Yes, it is. And I remember as a little boy reading this thinking, well, when I see a cowboy like John Wayne shooting 10 different bad guys, and he kind of living for another day, I believed it. Why? Because you look at this passage, it's amazing. So as we go through this, we're going to read a lot. We're going to read some strange names. But I want you to think, could I be one of these valiant men? Physically, probably not. No. But this is what we're saying spiritually. So we're going to find out some really cool things, but then we need to connect that with, can we be a soldier today for the Lord? Yes, we can. But I don't know, maybe I'm a little strange. I just love reading these stories, and as a little boy thinking, how could that ever happen? Well, it did. So we're going to start in verse 8. First thing I want you to do, King David's mighty men, at the top of the page, write Abishai. He's the first guy we're going to, I would say the top guy. A-B-I-S-H-A-I. And then we're going to have three guys below him, okay? And we'll read about the first one. Verse 8. These be the names of the mighty men whom David had. The Tachbonite that sat in the seat, chief among the captains. The same was Adino, the Ezonite. He lifted up his spear against 800 whom he slew at one time. 800. You know, you picture these movies or these cartoons of this warrior just destroying everybody. And we think, oh, that could never happen. It happened. There's a soldier of David named Adino, and he just killed 800. So right under Abishai, you're going to have three names. On the left, write Adino. He killed 800. Look at verse 9. And after him was Eleazar, the son of Dodo, the Elohite, one of three mighty men with David when he defied the Philistines that were gathered together to battle, and the men of Israel were gone away. He arose and smote the Philistines until his hand was weary and his hand clave unto the sword. And the Lord wrought a great victory that day, and the people returned after him only to spoil. So in verse 9 and 10, we hear about Eleazar. What did it say in verse 10? His sword clave unto the sword. Have you ever worked so hard, maybe with a shovel, working hour after hour, and then you could not maybe let it go? Or your hand was just stuck to it? Anybody? Okay, a few of you know what I mean. I remember my dad, and he had some strange ideas. He had me put in a split rail fence as a teenager. He said every boy should be able to chop a tree down in his life and put up a split rail fence. So I remember with the digging bar, remember those? Remember that? We didn't rent an oak, whatever they're called. No, it was physical. We had to do it. Well, I had to do it. So remember him sitting on the porch with his iced tea watching me do it. So I remember doing all that, putting it up, thinking, that's pretty good. Got the level and everything. And he saw me, saw it, and he's like, that's pretty good. But you know what? I think I want it in the backyard now. He was serious. I had to take him out, put it in the backyard. He had me do it twice. I still don't know why he did that. Maybe he thought doing it second would be, you know, better. I don't know. But I remember doing that digging bar, and my hands were like this. Even I had gloves on, they clave to it. So those of you who've done physical labor and you've done something like that, you can understand. And so verse 10, his hand was weary, his hand clave unto the sword. Well, yeah, you're fighting hundreds of Philistines. Maybe one sword, two swords in hand. After it was over, his hands were like this. There was a gentleman in our church. He was probably 80 years old when I was in high school. We called him the Claw. He was maybe 5 feet tall. Thin, but just you could tell he'd worked with his hands his whole life, construction worker. And so our job as little boys, we would go up to him every Sunday to shake his hand. And any of us who didn't wince won that day because his hand was a claw. Because I guess he had worked so much like that, his hand was permanent like this. And so when he shook our hands, our knees just kind of buckled, and that meant we lost. And we did this every Sunday, probably for a couple years as little boys. Because we were getting bigger, and we were thinking, we're as tall as this guy. But the claw got us every time. And he knew what we were doing. But I remember that scene of that guy's hand. Even though he was small in stature, physically strong. So when I see this, can you picture in your mind, this guy was fighting for hours probably, and his hand was stuck to the sword. Verse 11. So the middle guy right there, Eleazar. Verse 11. And after him was Shammah, the son of Agi, the Hararite. And the Philistines were gathered together in a troop where a piece of ground full of lentils. And the people fled from the Philistines. But he stood in the midst of the ground and defended it and slew the Philistines, and the Lord wrought a great victory. So the third guy, Shammah, S-H-A-M-M-A-H. So we have Abishai, who's the head guy. He's the chief. Under him were three guys, Adino, Eleazar, and Shammah. And then if you want to put under them, 11 men. So 11 men were under Adino, 11 men were under Eleazar, and 11 men were under Shammah, for a total of 37. So when we see valiant men or David's mighty men, these were the guys. And we're going to read about a few of them, and then at the end of the chapter, it lists all of them. But there was a few that he just had to tell about. And, you know, we have stories that our families maybe have passed down. You know, I can't imagine being a little boy in Israel and hearing about these soldiers. I would want to see, what does Adino look like? What does a man look like who killed 800 men by himself? I don't know, maybe I'm strange, but as a little boy, I thought, what would he look like? You know, we think of this great warrior. Were they 6-7 feet tall? No. No, probably 5.5 feet maybe. Okay, they weren't the tallest. Now, they did fight giants. So it's not the size of the, what's the saying? It's not the size of the dog in the fight, right? Did I say that wrong? It's the size of the fight in the dog. How important that is. You've seen little chihuahuas barking at huge Dobermans, and you're thinking, is he nuts? That's not going to work too well for him. But you see the fight, and so when we find out about these soldiers, that's what I think. They probably weren't big in stature, but tough. And so that was the first part. Those are the first three guys. And then the next story goes, the next few verses, King David's all tired. He's in a cave, and he's sitting there thinking, oh, if I had some water, if I had some water from the well in Bethlehem, if I just had a drink of that. And so what do these three guys do? Look at verse 13. And three of the 30 chief went down and came to David in the harvest time into the cave. And the troop of the Philistines pitched in the valley of Rephaim. And David was in the hold, and the garrison of the Philistines was then in Bethlehem. And David longed and said, oh, that one would give me drink of water of the well of Bethlehem. And look at verse 16. And the three mighty men break down the host of the Philistines and drew water out of the well of Bethlehem. So what did they do? They heard their king saying, oh, if I could have a drink from Bethlehem. So what do these three guys do? They take off for Bethlehem. They take off. They go to that well. Again, can you picture it? These are the Philistines. What do we think of Philistines? Who's the one guy we think of? Goliath. He was pretty big. I'm not saying all of them were that tall, but that's what we think of. These three guys run through the line, I can't picture this. Okay, you had one guy here guarding the well, one guy here, and the other guy getting water as the Philistines all around them. And then they take it back to David, and what does David do with it? Never understood this. So maybe some of the scholars in here can explain this. I don't know. Verse 16, the middle part. It drew water out of the well of Bethlehem, was by the gate, and took it and brought it to David. Nevertheless, he would not drink it. Therefore, but poured it out unto the Lord. Verse 17, and he said, be it far from me, O Lord, that I should do this. Is not this the blood of the men that went in jeopardy of their lives? Therefore, he would not drink it. I don't get that. These three guys just risked their life to bring you a thing of water. I'm sitting there, and there's a nice thing of water right there for me to drink. And he pours it out? What do you think that did to those three guys? In their mind, they're probably thinking, King, I just risked my life to get you a little drink of water, and you pour it out? I don't know. I'd be upset. Then again, I'm not one of these mighty men. So we don't know what was going through their mind. Then the next part, look at verse 18. Then Abishai, remember, this is the head guy. And Abishai, the brother of Joab, the son of Zerubbabel, was chief among the three. And he lifted up his spear against 300 and slew them and had the name among the three. Was he not most honorable of the three? Therefore, he was their captain. Howbeit, he attained not unto the first three. And we can go back and forth on this. Was he not as good of a soldier? Maybe he was older and these three guys were more in their prime. We don't really know, but he was their captain. We had the three guys, Adino, Eleazar, Shema. And then we had about 11 under them each. That meant each guy was in charge of about 433,000 men. Because we know there's about 1.3 million soldiers at that time. Let me make it straight. 800,000 from Israel, 500,000 from Judah. So 1.3 million men. But 37 are listed. And so what I'm trying to get here is we would want our name in here, wouldn't we? These men did something to get their name in this Bible. They were valiant. They were David's mighty men. So what I want you to do is write these things down. Four things. First, they were skilled. We go back to verse 8. These be the names of the mighty men whom David had. The Tabgharite that sat in the seat, chief among the captains, the same was Adino, the Ezraite. He lifted up his spear against 800. So number one, they were skilled. And these all start with S, so it's an easy way to remember them. They were skilled. Work like it all depends on you. Pray like it all depends on God. Think about that. Work like it all depends on you. Pray like it all depends on God. Where the Renford Grows. Anybody read that book? Oh, you should read that. I remember being in probably fifth grade reading that. It's about a little boy who wanted hunting dogs. I think of Mr. Tomlinson. Mr. Tomlinson bought a dog for his kids. Great guy, isn't he? Also happens to be a hunting dog. You know, now I'm sure his little boy probably hadn't put that together yet, but one day he will. Did he buy that dog for us? Or for Dad? Well, anyway, the story is about this little boy who wanted two hunting dogs. He lived in Oklahoma, had no money. His parents were poor farmers. And so this kid for 2 years sold fruit, worms, whatever, to fishermen just to save enough money to buy two dogs. Now, I don't know about you. I don't know if there's a kid in here who would work 2 years saving pennies to buy two coon dogs. I don't know, maybe. But the story goes, he gets them. And so the best hunting is in the bottoms. And he's down there, he's hunting, he's having a great time. They tree the coon in the biggest tree in the bottoms. So here's this little boy, probably 9 years old, looking at this huge tree, and there's a raccoon up there. And he got the dogs, they did their part, didn't they? They treed the coon, and the dogs are waiting for what? Little Billy Coleman to chop the tree down to get the coon down. But this tree was huge. So here's little Billy, gets his little axe. What's he start doing? Chopping away all day long. I guess his hands probably clave to that little axe. He couldn't do it. Story goes, he sits down and falls asleep at the tree. His parents are worried. They come and look for him. And there's mom and dad, right? Mom brings him dinner. She's worried about her son. Dad sees that picture. Of course, mom wants Billy to come home, right? It's getting late. What's dad say? No, he needs to finish what he started. So dad won over on that night, gave food to the little boy. They left. And I remember in the book, the little boy looks to God and says, God, you know, I've done everything you've asked. I worked hard. I saved my money. And now my dogs have done their part. And I can't do anymore. So he gets up. He keeps chopping and chopping. And of course, what happens? A wind blows. The tree falls. So I looked at it as a little boy. What? The boy didn't just sit there and say, God, help me get this raccoon. No, little Billy, what? He got his axe and he started chopping. Did everything he could. And maybe at the end, God sent a little breeze to push it over. I don't know. The whole thing was, you have to do your part, then God will do his. So that quote, work like it all depends on you, pray like it all depends on God. Number two, they were separated. Verse 9 and 10, there's Eleazar. He's out, and all of a sudden, the men of Israel were gone away, the bottom of verse 9. He's out there fighting, and the men of Israel left him by himself. So number two, they were separated. Sometimes you may have to fight by yourself. Sometimes you may have to do things on your own. Maybe your friends deserted you. I don't know. That doesn't give us an excuse not to do anything for the Lord if we're by ourselves. So number two, they were separated. Number three, they were stuck. Verse 11, it talked about his hand clave unto the sword. Stick to the task until it's done. They were stuck. Number three. And number four, they were standing. Verse 11 and 12, again, the same thing. He was actually, Shema was guarding the field of lentils, which really was the provisions brought to David when fleeing from Absalom. So that was their food. And so one guy again was defending. And what does it say at the bottom of verse 11? And the people fled from the Philistines. So here's another soldier fighting, and he looks around, and all of them are gone. He's fighting by himself. But number four, they were standing. What could you write on that? Defend, defend, defend. Defend what you believe in. Stand up for what you believe in. It's not always easy. I went to a Christian school my whole life. I went to a Christian college. Sometimes it's easy to hide in a Christian environment because everybody's good. Well, we're all sinners. But can you be that one person to take that stand to defend what's right? So they were skilled. They were separated. They were stuck. And they were standing. So now something to think about. Write this number down. 1.3 million. Then right underneath that, another number, 650,000. And then under that, 650,000 again, and 37. So this is where we're going to start connecting to today. Some are content just to be saved. So you can write that right by the 1.3 million. That whole army, they were fighting for the Lord. So some are content just to be saved. The first number for 650,000, some are content just to be well-behaved. Hey, I'm going to follow the rules. I'm going to do what's expected. I can do that. So some are content just to be well-behaved. That goes by the first 650,000. Then the next number, 650,000, some are content just to be above average. I'm not only going to follow the rules, I'm going to have a pretty good attitude about it. That's good. Remember, there are 1.3 million men in this army, right? So we just split the two of them up. Some want to be above average. Others, well-behaved, we'll just do what we're asked. But you know what? The last one, this is where we should be. This is where we should strive to get to. Some want to be all they can be for the glory of God. So right by 37, that should be us. Some want to be all they can be for the glory of God. And we'll read a little bit about this other gentleman. He wasn't the top three, but read about him, he should be. He's amazing. Everybody look at verse 20. Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, the son of a valiant man, remember the word valiant, of Kabzel, who had done many acts. He slew two lion-like men of Moab. He went down also and slew a lion in the midst of a pit in the time of snow. And he slew an Egyptian, a goodly man. And the Egyptian had a spear in his hand, but he went down to him with a staff and plucked the spear out of the Egyptian's hand and slew him with his own spear. Can you picture this? I don't want to trivial this. I don't. And I don't want to pick on anybody in here, but I remember years ago we were playing this little video game. And I think it was the Wii. That's the one you're supposed to exercise to get in shape, right? Not actually go out and play, but play the Wii. So I remember playing the basketball Wii, you know, and they have no hands. It's really weird. So we're playing it, and every time I got the ball, this person I was playing would just pluck it right out of my hands. I'm thinking, how could he do that? I could never steal it from him. First of all, how could he steal? He has no hands. But I'm sitting there trying to play, and he would steal the ball from me every time. I'm thinking, this is ridiculous. This kid's so much younger than me, and he's whooping me in this silly game of basketball with no hands. And so I just remember him just, you ever played that game? Hopefully a couple of you know what I'm talking about. Okay, most of you are thinking, he's nuts. I have no idea what he's talking about. But the whole idea, all of a sudden, the ball is just plucked. Just like that. And I know it's a bad example. But here's this guy going down and seeing this Egyptian. Now, in I think it's 2 Chronicles, it tells the same story, but it gives the guy's height, 5 cubits. It's about 7.5 feet tall. That's like Mr. Thomason standing on his chair, okay? 7.5 feet tall. And the height of this Jewish soldier, I don't know, maybe 5.5 feet tall. So he probably had 2 feet on him. So he goes down, this huge Egyptian has this, and I read it somewhere that his beam, weaver's beam, could be as big as a telephone pole. That's big. I don't know. But you can imagine this Egyptian, 7.5 feet tall, doesn't have a tiny little spear. I'm sure it's thick. So what's this guy do? This guy that we know as Benaiah. He basically takes the guy's spear from him, plucks it from him, and then what's he do with it? He kills him with his own sword, his own spear. That's an insult, isn't it? A guy 2 feet shorter than you goes down, basically plucks the spear from you, and kills you with it. Now, maybe I was a little boy and I was a little violent, and I just liked hearing these stories or picturing it. It's just amazing. Here, he goes down and he kills a lion in a pit at the time of snow. I would have been up there with my spear just throwing it. I wouldn't go down. Would anybody go down there? You're lying if you said you would. No. I look at it, hey, there's dinner, and God put him in a pit for me. I'm just going to take aim up here. He jumps down and kills him. And then later he talks about two lion-like men. My little mind starts wondering, what does a lion-like man look like? You know, we think of the beard, the guys living in the mountains of West Virginia. I shouldn't have said that, I'm sorry. We think of a wild, I don't know, but he killed two of them. And then a guy killing 800, a guy killing 300. Can we wrap our heads around that? Yes, these things happened. Because these were men fighting for the Lord, fighting for their king, more importantly, fighting for the Lord. And so, as a kid, trying to picture all this, Andre the Giant. Anybody know Andre the Giant? Oh, yeah. Okay. My great-grandmother. Wrestling was true. You could not tell the difference. I'm like 7 years old. It's like 1975, 6, 7. And she would say, Mikey, let's watch wrestling. Because every Saturday she watched wrestling. And she believed it was true. So when the guys had blood all over them, come on, it was packets of ketchup. We know that, right? These guys are great athletes, but it wasn't blood. I could not tell with that. She probably beat me. No, no, that's real. Wrestling's real. Look at the blood. That's real. And as a little boy, I knew it wasn't. But this one guy caught my attention. 7'5", 500 pounds, Andre the Giant. Born in France. Unbelievable. It's just the size of this guy. I'm thinking, 7'5", 500 pounds, that's a big guy. Then I'm a junior in high school, and I go watch his basketball game. And I see this guy play named Manute Bol, 7'7", from Sudan. Weighed 210 pounds. 7'7", 210 pounds. He was a stick. I remember watching, I stood on the second row of bleachers as he walked in the gym. When he walked in the gym, he ducked his head, played for a little school, Bridgeport, came down to play Mount St. Mary's, which is in Maryland. And our high school coach took us to this game, and we saw this guy walk in. First off, dark as dark could be. Dark man. 7'7". We had never seen anybody that tall. He walked by me, and I'm looking at him. I'm up two bleachers. And I just never saw anything like that. 27 points, 20 rebounds, 12 block shots. His team lost because that's all they had. They had two 6'6" guys guarding him, one on each side of him, and they could not stop him. Then he went on to the NBA, played like 10 years. But I'm trying to think in my mind. Here's a guy, 7'7", 200 pounds. Andre the Giant, 7'5", 500 pounds. So let's meet in the middle. Here's a guy, an Egyptian, a goodly Egyptian, 7'6". What do you think? 350 pounds maybe? That's a big guy. I saw Manute Bol. I see the height. I saw Andre the Giant on TV. He was a big guy. There were giants in the land. And yet here we have a story of a guy not only killing the giant, but taking his spear, adding insult to injury, and killing him with it. So I don't know about you, but reading this as a little boy and understanding these things happened. So when I later saw a John Wayne movie and him killing all the bad guys, it wasn't hard to believe. Why? 800? And so I'm sitting there thinking, if God could use these soldiers, and we had described what they were. They were fearsome, courageous. We can be soldiers today. There's a war going on now. And we have the best weapon right in your lap, and that's the Bible. What can we do with that? Well, you know, we need to read it. My youth pastor used to tell me, hey, Proverbs, today's what, February 20th? Read Proverbs 20. That's something simple you can do every day of the month. But you need to have that personal time. If you want to grow as a Christian, you got to read God's word. You know, these guys are physically imposing. Maybe they weren't real tall soldiers, but were they tough? Yes, they were. We just read the stories about what they accomplished. And they did this for their king. More importantly, they did it for their Lord. So we're wrapping it up here. First, you need to be skilled in the word of God. You take all these Bible classes. Listen, I think I'm working. I try to make myself believe this. I'm in the cafeteria eating, but I'm talking with you guys. So that's like work, isn't it? That's great. But I'm listening to you guys talk about what you've learned in your Bible classes, and it's amazing. Yeah, we can talk about sports and all that, and that's great. But just listening to you talk about what you believe, why you believe it, man, some of you've got it. And that's exactly what we need to push. But we need to be skilled in the Word of God. We need to know where to go in the Word of God. What it means. Listen, there's a lot of things in here I don't get. Why did David pour the water out? That makes me nuts. There are things we won't get. Maybe when we get to heaven, I'm going to look at him and say, why? Those guys risked their life for you. There's a reason. We're not going to get everything, but we need to read it. Number two, you need to be separated from the things of this world. Yeah, we do. We're like in a lifeboat. The world's all around us. We don't want that world in the boat. But yet we have to live in the world. I got that. But do we need to listen and watch and talk like the world? No, we need to be separate. Our neighbors need to know there's something different about us. Well, we wear a shirt and tie. Okay, goes more than that. So they need to be separated from the things of this world. Number three, you need to stick to the task at hand. Don't raise your hand. How many of you are procrastinators? You wait to the last minute. Because some of you have texted me like at 1, 2 in the morning. I'm thinking, what are you doing up? I hope you're doing homework. You know, procrastination, not a good habit to have. But you need to stick to the task at hand. When you have something to do, you do it. And do it till it's right. Number four, you need to take a stand for the Lord and defend what you believe in. You need to take a stand for the Lord and defend what you believe in. And I'll repeat those. You need to be skilled in the Word of God. You need to be separated from the things of this world. You need to stick to the task at hand. You need to take a stand for the Lord and defend what you believe in. And the great thing is, guys, look at verse 8. It talks about skilled. Number 9, verse 9, talks about being separated. Number 10, stuck. The word's clave, but it means stuck. And verse 11 and 12, verse 12. But he stood in the midst. So there's the words right there. Again, not rocket science. It's right there for us to see. How can we take that and put that into our lives? Again, in the middle of this, we said, you know, they were skilled. They were separated. They were stuck. They were standing. These are things we need to do as Christians. So here's the last thing. You can become a valiant, mighty soldier for God. You can do that in your home, in your dorm room, in your neighborhood, in your church, at your job. We should all say, I want to be a valiant, mighty soldier for the Lord. That should be it. Now, how do we go about doing that? Well, it starts with reading God's word. It starts with having a prayer life. That's the beginning. And letting our light so shine before men, that's our goal. We all fail every day. Yes, we do. But we need to sign up for duty. You know, some of you have been in the military. So at age 18, you signed up. You know, back in World War II, guys lied about their age just so they could go and fight. My dad did the same thing, 1961. He was 17, not 18. He forged, he wanted to go to Vietnam. He wanted to fight. It's a little different now. You don't have to go fight. Yes, as 18, as a young man, you'd register. I got that. But there's not a draft. But you know what? We are in God's draft. And we need to do our part. And right now you're learning every day how to be a good Christian. Mr. Tomlinson said this last night in my RA meeting. You know what? You're our students, yes. But number one, you're Christians. And when you do some knucklehead thing, guys, what you do? All the time. 12:30 at night, my wife's like, who are you talking to? I said, doesn't matter, just a knucklehead. It happens. But we look at you, I need to look at you as a Christian first. That's it. Yes, you're a student. You're going to make mistakes, and our job is to try to fix those as best we can. But you're a Christian. I need to treat you that way, because that's number one. And so can we be a soldier? Can we be like a Dino? That's our goal. We're going to kill 800 men in battle? Probably not. But we can take that, and we can be skilled in God's words to when it's time to talk to maybe 800 people at a meeting, you're able to do that. So take this chapter and look at it. Yes, it's great to read. As a little boy, I just loved the battles, the bad guys getting, you know, what they deserved. I love that. And then understanding if one guy could beat 800, maybe I have a shot. So God, again, is not asking us to go out on the battlefield with our weapon. But he is asking us to take what we have in our lap and let's do some good with it. And let's take that gospel to not only our neighborhood, but all over the world. So again, you need to be skilled in the word of God. You need to be separated from the things of this world. You need to stick to the task at hand. You need to take a stand for the Lord and defend what you believe in. So you can sign up today. Sign up to be that soldier for the Lord. There's no day like today.